I'm here today with Gordon DuGan, who's the CEO of Gramercy Property Trust. And Gordon, cannot thank you enough for taking the time today. Really, really appreciate it. The way I like to start my show is to have my CEOs talk a little bit about their lives growing up. So let's start there.
I had an unusual childhood in the sense that my father was a diplomat for the United States. So I was born in Bogota, Colombia. I lived in Venezuela, Mexico, the Philippines, South Korea, and New Zealand, and hadn't lived in the U.S. until I was 13 years old. And I came back, then my father was posted back at the State Department. And so I came back to the U.S. and didn't really know American culture very well. So it was a very interesting way to grow up.
And then in terms of your college career, where did you go to school?
So I went to the University of Pennsylvania, and I studied at Wharton undergrad. It was an interesting lesson for me in terms of picking colleges, because I looked at a broad variety of schools, and my father's advice was to not go into the Foreign Service as he had done, but to go into business. And I'd contemplated schools where it would have been more of a jumping off point for the Foreign Service. So having the choice to go to Penn and to go to Wharton undergrad was a great choice. So I obviously took that, had a great time there, worked pretty hard, but also had a good time. And you know, it's a fabulous place, obviously.
And in terms of really leading into your next career, I believe you met Bill Carey at school, is that correct? And Bill Carey was the founder of W.P. Carey, just to give a little bit of context.
Bill was a prominent alumnus, and he would give the fraternity money every year. And so he would give money each year. For him, not a lot of money, although he was very generous. But for us, as an undergraduate fraternity, it was a fortune, you know, and it would allow us to have fun parties and things like that. When he came to visit the school, I was president of the fraternity at the time, so it was my job to kind of tour him around. And he obviously had built a very impressive business and ended up making an offer to have me work for him for the summer. And I worked for him for the summer and then went to work right after that as basically an analyst in the investment department, building models and doing whatever people told me to do.
You came on as an analyst, and the really neat thing is you actually went from analyst to become the CEO of the company. Tell us about that journey.
Yeah, obviously when you get a job straight out of college, you don't think about, will I become CEO of this company? It wasn't really on my mind. There are a lot of forces that ended up playing out. Some of those forces, some of the things that you can't anticipate, I worked very hard, obviously. That's, it's kind of trite, but it's true. I've worked a ton of hours. I liked what I was doing. I think that showed I had a passion for it. And ultimately, what happens in an organization are the skill set you have when you're a junior person may or may not be the skill set you need to move up through an organization. And for me, I was good enough at the quantitative things that I needed to do as a more junior person to rise in an organization. But I really liked the process of leading. I liked the process of being a spokesperson for the company and selling the vision of what we were trying to do. And I think those skills, interestingly, you're not hired for those skills. Yeah. You're hired to just do the work. But those skills are the skills that become more important as you transition through a company. And a lot of times that's what ends up being kind of the barrier for somebody, is they're very good at one thing, but that one thing that got them in the door isn't the thing that gets them into higher and higher roles. You know, it was a great journey. We had a great run with the company.
We interview all sorts of investment bankers and hedge fund managers and private equity folks. You're focused on the real estate space, and you're now the CEO of Gramercy Property Trust. Tell us a little bit about what you guys do and what makes you unique.
I left W.P. Carey, and two of the top team members at W.P. Carey left with me. We ended up taking over Gramercy. And what we decided to do was a lot of what we had done at W.P. Carey, but we thought we could do it even better than we had. We learned from some of our mistakes, even though we had a great track record at W.P. Carey. And so we decided to focus on buying high-quality real estate with medium to long-term leases in major markets around the United States. And that real estate is almost exclusively industrial and office properties. in cities like Los Angeles, Dallas, Atlanta, Austin, Texas. What we set out to do was build a best-in-class industrial and office company focused on major cities. And we took over a very small company. We've grown it very substantially. We've been the best performing REIT in the United States over the last 3-year period that we've been running this company. So we've had a great run in terms of executing the business plan. And it takes a a whole team of people out here to execute it.
Well, actually, you know what it takes? It takes courage. And what do you have next to you?
So this is
That's how he starts his meeting.
This is a prop. It's an axe with the word courage on it. It sort of reminds me of a couple of things. To grow a small company, you're in the chopping wood business. Every day you got to go in and move the ball down the field. And so there's a nice sort of reminder there. And I love the word courage because it's, in every aspect of our lives, personally and professionally, there are times when you need to be reminded of the fact to just sort of press on. And, they're like in any business, there are days when, the end of the day rolls around, I'm ready to pull my hair out. Luckily I've not managed not to use the axe on anybody. It's kind of a symbolic thing for me.
In terms of finding properties to invest in, there's a lot of money out there today and there's a lot of competition. How do you figure out what to invest in?
Commercial real estate's an interesting business. It's one of the most inefficient businesses there is. Relationships really matter. People do business with people they want to do business with. Pricing has to be, relatively equivalent. But in the business that we're focused on, having relationships with people that you've done business with for many years, that you do what you say you're going to do. You close deals on time, on terms. Those things really matter.
Do you worry about the real estate market? Oil has been crushed over the last, several months. Do you ever see something like that happening in real estate, or do you feel pretty confident about the market?
The one nice thing about real estate is it's predictable in the sense that there is always a cycle, and things always get overdone. I've been fortunate enough to be around for the early 90s recession in commercial real estate, which was interestingly much worse than this recent recession for commercial real estate. The financial crisis, public REITs proved that access to capital markets would ameliorate the ups and downs, or at least the down of a commercial real estate recession, because companies were able to tap into the capital markets and raise equity. In the early 90s, there was just no liquidity. There was no money for anything. There were no lenders, there was no equity. There was nothing, and that was a very scary. That was a similar time, for me. Even though I was a more junior person, I remember thinking, why did I go into commercial real estate? This is the worst business in the world. But you quickly learn that things that look, very dire do come back eventually, and commercial real estate always acts like that. My own view on where we are in the cycle is we're clearly upcycle. We're clearly in a time that is not a trough in any sort of way, shape, or form. There's a lot of capital out there, but it doesn't feel like 2007 to me. And 2007, which was really the peak of the last commercial real estate cycle, was very, very different. So the way I like to think about it, it might be sort of 05 or 06, but with a much flatter slope. 05, 06, 07, capital came in like this. There were CDOs, all types of capital providers to the commercial real estate industry. And it's recent enough that people have memories of that. So, I think it might be 05 or late 05 in a similar term. But 05 to 07 this time could take 5 or 7 years before the top of the cycle. When I was at W.P. Carey in 05, 06, 07, we had a private fundraising business, and I made the decision to shut down fundraising for all of 2007. So we didn't raise a nickel at a time when people were raising billions of dollars, because we weren't prescient about when the cycle was going to turn, but I just knew we couldn't get the money out the door and meet our underwriting criteria. You either had to change your underwriting criteria or you had to stop taking investor money. So we stopped taking investor money. So hopefully we'll have that same discipline, and I feel good we'll have a similar discipline if we get to a similar crazy cycle. This is not a crazy cycle in commercial real estate. We're still on an upswing. Fundamentals are good. There is a lot of capital, but if you have a, you know, if you have a well-defined niche and a good team, it's actually a terrific time to be investing money.
Okay, so Gordon, let me ask you one final question. You're at your alma mater and you're giving the commencement speech. What sort of advice would you give young people today?
Every interview I have with a young person, I tell them, find, you know, working with people you like and have similar values to is one of the most important aspects of job satisfaction, and hopefully that permeates the culture of whatever organization is. And we try very hard at Gramercy to try to have that culture. You know, work hard, have fun, you know, and find like-minded people.
Got it. I think that's super, super advice. Again, I'm here with Gordon DuGan, who's the CEO of Gramercy Property Trust. And Gordon, cannot thank you enough for your time.
My pleasure.
What you've done through your career is really impressive stuff. And thanks so much.
Thanks, Kitty.